Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service of worship here in Moreau Presbyterian Church. A warm welcome also to all those who are listening to this service online. We pray that as we meet together to worship God, we will be very aware of his presence with us today. There are just a couple of announcements. Primary school age children are invited to go over to the hall after children's talk for children's church. Thanks to Lorna and Andrew Irwin, who will be leading this. A live stream of the service is available in the creche for anyone who would like to avail of this opportunity. I would like to remind you about our holiday Bible club, which will take place from Monday the 5th of August until Friday the 9th of August from 10:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. each morning. The theme this year is Ready, Steady, Go for God. All children from P1 to P7 will be made very welcome. Please do tell family and friends about this week. The team is asked to meet for a short time in the creche after the service. Committee members are also asked to wait for a few moments after the service as well. Meet Up Monday will continue to meet over the summer period. You're warmly invited to come along. We really do encourage you to join us at our prayer meeting this Wednesday evening, the 10th of July at 7:30 p.m. It is hard to believe that we are at the start of another new month. There will be a cup of tea served over in the hall at the close of the service. Please don't rush away. It will be a good to continue fellowship with a cup of tea. Thank you to Christine for playing for us this morning while James is on holiday. Anyone requiring the services of a minister while the Reverend Jones is on holiday should contact me. I would like to welcome the Reverend Johnson Lamb to our pulpit this morning. You're very welcome here in Moreau, and we look forward to hearing what God has laid upon your heart to share with us today.
Thank you very much for your kind words of welcome. It's good to be with you this morning. The last occasion I was here was at your harvest, and it's nice to be back this morning to share fellowship and to share around God's word. The psalmist reminds us this morning, I will praise you, O Lord, with my heart. I will tell of your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. And as we come this morning, we want to praise God and worship him. And our opening praise is number 59 in Mission Praise, and it's Blessed Assurance.
Thank you.
join together in prayer. Let's all pray. Loving Father, again this morning, we thank you for this wonderful privilege given to us to draw aside into your presence. Lord, as we come, we acknowledge again and afresh our sinfulness, seeking your cleansing and your forgiveness, seeking that renewed spirit within us, that as we go forward into the week that lies ahead, we will be constantly assured of your presence surrounding us. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings of life that you shower upon us. We thank you that you are indeed the faithful God, the one who is unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever, and the one who guards and minds the steps of his children. So this morning, as we come before you, we rest ourselves in you, blessing you as the Almighty One, the one who can do more than we could ever ask and think, and thanking you for how you have led and guided our lives to this point. We pray, Lord, that you will draw close to us as we seek to sing your praises and read your word. We pray afresh this morning that you will speak into all our hearts, reminding us of our need of trusting in you day by day, reminding us of all that you have done for us on Calvary's cross, reminding us, Lord, that if we are to know that peace of God that passeth all understanding, we are to experience the grace of God in our heart, brought about and bought by the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, shed on Calvary's cross. Be with us this morning as we meet together in this place, and those who join with us via technology, we pray that they too would know the nearness of your presence. But also we remember those who are on holiday, that you'll give them times of refreshment and renewal. And we think especially of Jeff and Elspeth, that you'll be onto them all that they need in these days. Encourage and bless them. But Lord, this morning we look to you, our great and our mighty God, and we seek your encouragement and your blessing as we share together. So we pray in Jesus' lovely name. Amen. If you have your Bible there with you, we're reading from Psalm 3 this morning. Psalm 3. And let's hear God's word as we come together. O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you are a shield around me, O Lord, my glorious one who lifts up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the jaw. You have broken the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. And we thank God for his word this morning. I don't know if you read, as you were listening through that, in verse 7, you have a wonderful picture of God. At least for me, it's a wonderful picture of God. It says, arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God, for you have struck all my enemies on the jaw. You have broken their teeth. You have broken the teeth of the wicked. What a picture of God standing on our defense. I have this wonderful picture with God with his two fists up. And anybody that comes up against us, he's there to defend us and to protect us. What such a wonderful God we have. Boys and girls, I know there's only one or two of you. Come on up to the front. I'm going to talk to you for a few minutes. It's good to see you here. Are you going to go to the Holiday Bible Club? Yes? Good. I know in my congregation that I worship with now, ours is coming up at the beginning of August, and it's all about the Olympics, and I'm assuming that's maybe a bit of the theme of, what is it, ready, steady, go for God. Yeah, all fits nice with the Olympics, doesn't it? All fits nice with the Olympics. Now, tell me this. If someone did something really nice for you, what would you do? Say thank you, yeah. But how might you say thank you? Not just in words. What might you do? How could you acknowledge it in a way that they would be really, really encouraged? Any ideas? No? Who would send a letter or a little card? Would you? A nice little thank you card to say thank you. Just a wee note to say thank you for something that you have done for them or they have done for you. What else might you do? Does anybody remember seeing the television advertisement about the little girl who wanted to tell her mummy that she loved her? You remember that advertisement? No, you don't watch television. You might remember it. Oh, yes. What did she do? She went in to get a bar of chocolate in the shop. And what did she do? She gave everything that she had was of great worth. There was a few buttons. There might have been one coin and her little My Little Pony, wasn't it? And she put it on the counter and she said, I want to buy a bar of chocolate for my mommy. And wasn't the shopkeeper very kind? He said, you've got change. Change out of a button, a coin, and My Little Pony. What was her change? Do you remember? Her My Little Pony. It probably was the most precious thing that she had, and the shopkeeper gave it back. But she wanted to say thank you to her mommy and to say, I love you. You know, today in our world, we don't often stop to say thank you to people. I'm always amazed when someone maybe drops me a wee card and says thank you for something that I've done. I don't expect it, but it's lovely when it happens. But you know, in the Bible, we're told of a story. The story of 10 men, and their life was extremely difficult. Extremely difficult, because they had a disease called leprosy. Now, leprosy still exists today around the world, but there are much better treatments. Lots of folk are not completely healed, but they're able to get back into life in some sort of normality. But in Jesus' time, if you had that disease, nobody wanted to know you. In fact, your family would have told you to leave your house. You wouldn't have been allowed to go to temple. You wouldn't have been allowed to do anything at all with normal people. That's people who were well. And so they lived apart from everyone else. And their life was difficult. And the nature of the disease made it very difficult for them, because some of them lost their fingers and their toes, and some of them lost their feet. Life was very difficult. But these 10 men met Jesus. And Jesus was able to heal them. And Jesus said, now, what I want you to do is I want you to go back to the temple and take the gift and say to the priest and ask him to examine your body to see that all of the disease was gone. But he didn't ask them to do anything else other than don't tell anyone. Just go to the priest. Sometime later, only one came back. And what did he come back to do? To say thank you. To say thank you to Jesus for what he had done for him. How he had healed him. He'd given him back his life. He'd given him back his family. He'd given him back everything that was worth something for him in this world. Saying thank you. And you know, it's important that we say thank you. Thank you to our mums and dads. Did anybody buy a teacher present at the end of term? Who bought it? Mum? Yes, exactly. But it's to say thank you, isn't it? For all the hard work that your teacher did during the year. And maybe you didn't like your teacher, but you gave her a present anyway, did you? Yes. But you know, it's important to say thank you to those that are around us, those that we love, and those that care for us. But most of all, it's important to say thank you to our God for Jesus, our wonderful Savior, who came into the world to be our friend. And I hope, boys and girls, that you take time every day to say thank you for all the good things that God has given us and for his Son, our Savior. Now, we're going to sing your hymn, and if I of his Father I place into your hands. Is that right? And then I think you're heading out to junior church, is it? Good job. Thank you for your help. I think, girls, you're allowed to leave. Well, we're going to worship God with our morning offering. Well, again, let's join together in prayer. Loving Father, this morning we thank you for the blessings of life that you shower upon us. We thank you for the means by which we are able to live within this world, and for that bounty we praise you. But Lord, this morning we bring our tithes and our offerings. We pray that you will take them and use them as you will, give wisdom and stewardship for those who are responsible for our gifts. And we pray that our giving will indeed bless your name, but also seek to advance the kingdom of God. Lord, we thank you for this congregation. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for its witness. And we pray that you'll continue to encourage and bless it. But Lord, this morning we are very conscious that we are part of the wider church of Jesus Christ, not only within the Presbyterian Church in Ireland, but your church worldwide. And we thank you that we can partner with so many to see the work of your kingdom extend in these days. And we pray, Lord, that you will watch over us as a denomination. We pray, Lord, in these days of change and challenge, that you'll enable us to be that effective witness for yourself. We thank you for those new congregations that have been born in these last years. We thank you for new planting congregations at this time and for new opportunities to witness in parts of this island that we have never had before. We pray that you will add your blessing to those who are laboring faithfully for yourself. Encourage them. May they indeed have the joy of seeing men and women, boys and girls, coming to a living faith in the Lord Jesus. But Lord, too, this morning, we pray for our province. And we pray as we move forward in these days that you will guide and direct our politicians. May they ever be aware that they hold office under the authority of a great God. While some may not give acknowledgement to him, we pray, loving Father, that you will make your presence known in every and in all situations and in every and all decisions that are made by our leaders. Lord, we pray that you will guide and direct the affairs not only of this country, but also of these islands. And we pray that in the coming days, as we see so many changes, that you would indeed add your blessing in your will. Loving Father, we were reminded last evening at the convention of the fact that while many of us cannot go to the world is coming to us here in this island. And we think of those here from various countries around the world that we now have opportunity to witness to. We pray that as a church and as individuals, we'll be ready to give that reason for the hope that we have in Christ Jesus, that we have a Savior who died, a Savior who has risen, and a Savior who has come again. And we pray that we'll have that there will be that sense of urgency in our declaration of our Savior and of the grace of God. Lord, we thank you for our time this morning, and we pray as we meet around your word, as we continue to sing your praises, that indeed you will have all the honor and glory because you alone are worthy. But Lord, we're also mindful of those who cannot be with us. We think some who are not so well at the moment, at home or in hospital or in nursing homes. We pray that they will be ever conscious that we are praying for them. We remember those, Lord, who find this time of the year difficult because of the loss of a loved one, who have just recently lost loved ones. May they be comforted and assured of your presence. So we commit and commend ourselves into your hands, giving thanks for answered prayer and asking that your will be done in all that we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I said, it's a joy to be with you this morning. Before singing the next hymn, I'll tell you the reason why I'm here. Part of the reason is that I'm a good friend of Jeff. I've known Jeff for the best part of 35 plus years from our days together in the work of the Belfast City Mission. But also, I am in this part of the world this weekend because of Keswick at Port Stewart. Now, I don't know whether many of you have actually been down at Keswick, past or present, but the meetings began yesterday and will be running this week. And I couldn't help who was sent to make sure that the television screen was turned on, because yesterday when I arrived down, I'm responsible for the site in Port Stewart, and we have a contractor. It's actually our moderator's son. I've lost his name there for a moment. Andrew, who's responsible for all our lighting and for all our technology. And we arrived down yesterday morning, and the water was streaming through our television screens. Such was the rain, and none of us were prepared to turn on the televisions lest they blew up. So we had to send for a member of his team, and he came down. He said, "Well, just leave it a wee while, let it dry out. But there's water in front of the screen." I don't know whether anybody noticed it last night, but we trust that it will last the week. But it's a good opportunity this week, if you're free, to join us any morning at 11 o'clock for our Bible readings. It's a chap called John Risborough. And in the evening, tonight, it's chap Genoa. And tomorrow, the rest of the week, it's a fellow called David Cassidy. I say a fellow. He's bigger than I am, a massive guy, and he's going to be the speaker each of the evenings, and we look forward to his ministry of those evenings. So your invitation is extended to you, and if you there's a creche, if any of the family have children, that they can share in that as well. And we're praying that God would lead and guide in this incoming week. But before we turn to God's word, we're going to sing another praise. Christine's not getting peace to sit. And it's the hymn number 894 in Mission Praise. My Jesus, I love you. Friends, I want to share with you this morning some thoughts from Psalm number 3. And the context of this psalm is beautifully explained by the title of the psalm. Psalm 3, a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. This is the first psalm recorded to David in the book of Psalms. And it is a challenging period in the life of David. The main protagonist in the story is Absalom, his third son. He was, by all explanations, quite a charismatic character. He was head and shoulders above everyone else in the court. He was known as a man's man, but yet he was very vain about his appearance. He had this long flowing hair, which he cut only once a year. And we're told in the scriptures that when they did cut it, they weighed it, and it weighed something like 5 pounds in weight, and ultimately it would be his downfall. But he was a man who could draw people around him. When he was in a room, he was the center of attention, and he could talk to anyone, and he was just one of those individuals. But he wasn't the wisest of men, because he sought to overthrow God's anointed as king, his father David. He thought he was too old, too unable to carry on the duties of the king. But there were two really substantial factors in play when Absalom decided that he would rebel against his father. And the first was a family matter. It was regarding his sister Tamar. Tamar, by all accounts, was beautiful. And Absalom had another brother, a half-brother called Amnon, who decided that he was going to not take her life, but take her virginity. And we're told that he violated his daughter and then rejected her. Violated his sister and then rejected her. And we're told that this angered his brother Tamar, that he should treat his sister so badly. The scriptures tell us his lust for her was great, but his hatred after the event was even greater. And we're told that Absalom decided that he had to deal with his brother because his father did nothing. He just let this situation pass without comment or without action. And we're told that Absalom placed his brother at a particular point in the battle and he instructed his armies that he should be killed. And the second factor in play at this rebellion was a man called Ahithophel, who was the chief advisor of David. And we're told in the scriptures that he changed sides from being on David's side for so many years, being faithful to David. He changed sides and he followed Absalom, David's son. And why was that? Well, we're told that Ahithophel was the grandfather of Bathsheba. And he was disgusted and angered and disappointed by David, how he had treated her. And we're told of the story of Bathsheba's husband, Uriah the Hittite, who David placed in the forefront of the battle so that he would be killed, so that he could take Bathsheba as his wife. What a lethal combination of two men. One who was angry at his father, both of whom were angry at their father for different reasons, and both who saw David as a liability to the nation. And we're told that they set about destroying David's rule and David's kingdom. And this psalm is set in the context where David fled Jerusalem, eventually leading to one final strategic battle. And even in that, David had a concern for his son, that Absalom should not be killed. Ultimately, he was. He was caught by his hair in the trees, and his general Joab gave instruction for him to be killed as he hung there. These men would later pay the price for not fulfilling the instructions of David. So this psalm is set in the center of intrigue and betrayal and personal excruciating trial for David. And in the midst of this, David comes to some momentous conclusions about God. And as such, speaks to us this morning where we are, about our experience of God. David comes before God and he addresses him first as Lord. If you've got your Bible there, you'll see that word Lord in capital letters. That's the personal name of God. That name was given to Moses to refer to God as Yahweh, the I Am God. And here David comes and he speaks, God, my God. And we're told that David was indeed a man after God's own heart. In fact, the scripture says that he was a friend of God, even though at times he rebelled, even though at times he did his own thing, even times he sinned, he still had a heart for God and God loved him. And he comes before God and he cries out about the situation that he finds himself in. And he takes comfort in three pictures that he paints for us here of what God is like for him. And he says in the verse that he is my shield, my glory, and the lifter of my head. Verse 3, he is my shield. A shield of protection. A shield about me. Now, if you have ever read Ephesians chapter 6 there, you know the story of the armor of God, where God has given to us an armor to protect us as the people of God, a helmet, a breastplate, a belt, a shield, a sword, and sandals. all to enable us to engage in Christian warfare for him. But the key for any soldier is a shield. But the shield that's talked about in Ephesians chapter 6 is a shield which only has a front guard, which the soldier would put in front of him to distract the spears and the arrows. But here in this particular passage, what David is talking about is that God is my total shield. It's spoken of in Lamentations chapter 3 as a wall that is around us. It's told in Genesis chapter 15, a promise that is given to Abraham as he goes into battle. He said that God surrounds me with his presence. He is a shield in Psalm 18 to all who take refuge in him. What sort of shield is this? It's a shield where God goes before. It's a shield where God comes beside us. It's a shield where God comes behind us. And it's a shield that covers us. We are totally surrounded by God's presence and by God's protection as the people of God. We are quite literally in the hands of God. And that's the conclusion that David came to. His only hope was in the fact that he was in the hands of God. You know, sometimes as followers of Jesus Christ, when we face all of the anxieties of life, maybe about our health, our finances, our job, our families, we need to be reminded that we are, as the people of God, in the hands of God, and that he does protect us. And nothing happens to us outside his knowledge and will. You know, sometimes those arrows penetrate the shield, but they're allowed by God for purpose. Sometimes it is to purify us from sin. The trials and tests of life that we face are to bring us to that place of a fresh commitment to God. David was suffering in this moment for his past sins. And in these moments, these trials and these tests were for to remind him that he had to trust in God, had to rest his life in God. God sometimes allows these tests to come in our lives to teach us something new, to give us a new perspective on our lives. Someone has said it's only when we're on our backs that we look up. And it's only literally when we come to the end of ourselves sometimes that we cry out to God and we see him for who he is, when in reality we should be looking to him at all the moments of our lives. And maybe he's also allowing those tests and trials to come to remind us that we are to become more like Christ, to be drawn closer to him, to rest in his hands. So when David talks here, he comes to the understanding that God is his shield. He is the one who protects, the one who surrounds him, the one who is his greatest strength. All of us go through those challenging moments. It's important that we rest in God. And the second conclusion that David comes to in these verses, he is my glory. He says, in him I boast. He is my God. Now, there's a word here that's in the Hebrew, and I'm no Hebrew scholar, but it is the word for glory. But it's a slightly nuanced word, and it literally means my glory. It reads glory, but it means my glory. What's he saying? He said, God is my only boast. God is to be the one that I take glory in, that he is my God, he is my Savior, he is my friend. Throughout Scripture, we are given wonderful pictures to those who meet and have met with God, acknowledging the glory of God. We're told by Isaiah the prophet how that on a day he was brought up into the temple, and for the very first time, he saw the glory of the Lord. He said, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his glory filled the temple. And when I saw that glory, I saw my sin. And I saw my need of cleansing and forgiveness, and we're told that the angel of God came and brought a living fire from off the altar and touched his mouth and cleansed him and made him anew. Yes, the glory of God. But David is saying here, he is my glory. He's talking about a personal experience and understanding of who God is. What he was saying, it's in God I take my pride. It's in him I pride. It's in him I honor. It's in him I hold everything of my life in his hands. You know, Romans tells us we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Mankind has sought glory in all manner of things, turning their back on God. But as followers of Jesus Christ, our only desire should be the glory of God. For David, at this moment in his life, he had lost everything. His throne, his crown, his kingdom, his armies, his family, and his son. Everything that was precious to him was trampled into the dust and dishonor. But the one and only important thing for him at this moment in time was that God is his glory. That God was his entire life. His entire life. That's where his center was in God. We all in this world search for personal glory. It should not take us away from God. God is to be the very heart of our lives. David echoes that in Psalm 27. He says, "One thing I have desired of the Lord, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and to behold the beauty," or to behold the glory of the Lord. His desire was to be always in God. And the third picture that David gives us here is that he is the lifter of my head. That's a powerful word picture. I don't know whether you've been watching the football. You can't miss it. It's on every channel and seems to be on for every hour of the day. But it's interesting to see some of those who have lost their matches and to watch them walking off the pitch. They're not dancing off the pitch. They're walking off the pitch with their heads down. Why? Because they've lost. I have three grandsons that are staying with us at the minute, and the oldest one is football crazy. When you see him, he's a ball at his foot, and he just loves football. He plays for a wee team, and he goes to this training, and when he comes home on a Friday night, he usually stops into the house with his mother or his father, depending who's able to take them that night. And we know as soon as he walks up the drive whether it's been a good match or a bad match. If it's been a bad match, the head's down. And it's the referee's fault. It's this person's fault or that person's fault. The head's down. But when he's won, the head's up. 2 weeks ago, got man of the match. You couldn't have angered him for anything. He got his McDonald's little voucher to go and get a happy meal. He had made it. He was just so delighted. But here, God is saying, and David has come to the conclusion, God is the only one that can lift me up. He said, yes, everything around me is destroyed. The picture, parallel passage to this is 2 Samuel, where we're told the story of David's anguish at this moment. He goes to the Mount of Olives. Significant passage and a significant place. The one greater than David would go to the Mount of Olives, and there too he would sweat great blood, drops of blood as he yielded himself to the Father's will. David comes. And he kneels in that garden and he covers his head, mourning about what had happened. And he bowed his head and he just cried out to God. His world was gone. You know, that's our natural condition when things happen to us. We get the head down. Things aren't going the way we want them to go. Things aren't happening the way we thought they should have happened. And we get discouraged. But the good news is that we can have our heads lifted up and we can see light at the end of the tunnel. We can see our fortunes restored, if you like. And when David came before God, he recognized that he was the only one that could lift him up. He was the only one that could lead him through the trials that he was facing. And he was the only one that could restore to him the joy that he had lost. God alone can turn our sorrow into joy. He is the only one that will and can help us. In our weakness, he brings strength. We need to look to God as David did. David would also write, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is the stronghold of my faith. He will lift my head above mine enemies." Maybe today you're going through some horrendous difficulties. Maybe you're going through some challenges in your life or your family. It's in those moments that we need to turn to God. Why is it that we don't turn to him first and foremost? Why don't we come to him in prayer when situations happen? Because we try to work them out in our own strength and in our own way. When God says, "Come, cast all your care upon me." God says, "Come in your weakness and find strength and help in me." David, as he penned this psalm, yes, was in one of the most challenging situations of his life. His son rebelled against him. His chief advisor rebelled against him. His armies rebelled against him. His only hope was in God. His only hope was in the one who was his shield to protect him and guard him. His only hope was in the one he took glory in, his only boast. He found his being in God, very existence of God. And he found hope in the fact that God alone could lift his head and show him, yes, there is light at the end of this tunnel. I will see you through. I will lead you through. And you will know my peace that passeth all understanding as you rest yourself in me and my will. I trust this morning that every single one of us will know God's protection, that we will experience his glory in our lives, and we will indeed have our heads lifted up and say, "Yeah, you're on the victory side. I will see you through right to the very end." The greatest promise, I believe, that's given in Scripture is in Matthew chapter 28, where Jesus said, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the very end." Not just to the end of the world, to the very end of time. "Then I will be able to present you perfect in my name before the Father in glory." Let's pray together. Loving Father, again, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for the experience of David, who enables us to understand your grace and your power in our lives. And we pray this morning that we indeed would be found trusting and resting in you, knowing you as our shield, knowing you as our defender, knowing you as our greatest boast, knowing you as the one who lifts up our head. Because, Lord, we are traveling, each one of us at times, through turbulent and troubled waters. But we know that there's rest and peace in yourself. So we ask, Lord, that you'll take your word, write it upon our hearts, apply it as you will, for the glory and honor of your name. So we pray. Amen. We're going to sing as our closing praise that great hymn, "I Stand Amazed in the Presence."
Thank you.
Loving Father, we thank you for being with us this morning. We pray as we part that your grace, mercy, and peace will be our blessing today and forevermore. Amen.